Welcome to lecture series on matrix analysis with applications. So today we will deal with vector and matrix norms. What do you mean by a vector norm and how can you find out a matrix norm? So let us discuss in this lecture. First is, what do you mean by norm of a vector? Okay. The norm of a vector x, which may be in Rn or in Cn, I mean Cn means complex tuple, is a real valued function which is defined from Rn or Cn to R. It is always a real value which satisfies the following axioms. The first axiom is positivity. Positivity means norm of any vector x is always greater than or equal to 0 for any x, and norm of x is equal to 0 if and only if x is itself 0. Second property is homogeneity. That means norm of kx, where k is a scalar which is in R or C, is equal to mod of k into norm of x. The third property is subadditivity, which is norm of x plus y is less than equals to norm of x plus norm of y. Something like triangular inequality, where x, y belongs to Rn or Cn. So if a vector x satisfying these three properties, then that is called norm of that vector. That is a norm induced in that vector. So there are different type of norms which can be induced on Rn or Cn. Okay. Now let us discuss these things by an example. Suppose you are in Rn. Okay. Then the norm 1, we are calling is norm of x 1. Okay, norm 1 of vector x, which is x 1, x 2 up to x n, is defined as sum of x i's, mod of x i's, where I is varying from 1 to n. So let us discuss this thing. So x is in Rn, x which is x 1, x 2 up to x n, up to x n is in Rn. Okay. How we are defining norm of this x here? The norm of this x we are defining as, this is we are calling as norm 1. It is summation I from 1 to n, it is mod of x I. I mean sum of mod of this, mod of this, mod of this, sum of all the mods, all the absolute values of this set. If you take x as suppose 2 minus 1, 4, which is in R3, then norm 1 of this vector is simply mod of 2 plus mod of minus 1 plus mod of 4, which is 7. Now, is it a norm? First of all, is it a norm? How can we show that it is a norm? So, in order to show that this is a norm, we have to show the three axioms which we have studied earlier. Now, the first axiom is norm of x is always greater than or equal to 0, okay, which is true because sum of absolute values can't be less than 0. We are taking the modulus and then we are adding them. It can't be less than 0. So, which is true, okay. This is true since mod of x I is always greater than or equal to 0 for all I, and hence sum will be sum over I of mod of x I will also greater than or equal to 0. So, this is true. Now, norm of x 1 equal to 0 if and only if x is equal to 0. Now, if x equal to 0, suppose this vector is a 0 vector, then of course, the sum of the absolute values is 0. So, the first part is over. Now, if norm of x 1 is equal to 0, then this means mod x 1 plus mod x 2 and so on up to mod x n is equal to 0. If sum of positive values, all are positive values, is equal to 0, this means what? This means each x I is equal to 0 for all I, because this is positive, this is positive, this is positive, and sum of positive quantities is equal to 0. This means each quantity is 0. And mod of x I equal to 0 means what? X I equal to 0 for all I. So, this means x equal to 0. So we have shown that first property holds, which is positivity. Now let us try to show a second property. Second property is norm of kx. That means you multiply this vector x by k, by a scalar k. Okay. So what will be the norm of this? By the definition, this will be mod of summation I from 1 to n mod of kxi, which is equals to summation over I mod of k mod of xi. By the definition, this k is a scalar quantity, can be taken out. So it is mod of k sum over I mod of xi, and this is simply mod of k into norm of x, norm 1 of x. So we have shown that norm of kx is equals to mod k times norm of norm 1 of x. So second property holds. Now the third axiom is mod of x plus y, norm of x plus y is less than equals to norm of x plus norm of y. How we can show this? This is equal to sum of I from 1 to n mod of xi plus yi. Here x is x1, x2, x3 up to xn, and y is y1, y2, y3 up to yn. Okay, x is this quantity and y is y1, y2 up to yn. Okay. Now mod of this quantity, now we can easily see. Now here it is norm of x plus y, norm 1 of x plus y is equal to sum of I from 1 to n mod xi plus yi. Okay. Now mod of xi plus yi is always less than equals to mod xi plus mod of yi for all I. This is by the property of modulus, I mean mod. So this implies sum will also be less than equal to, okay, sum over I mod xi plus sum over I mod yi. And this implies norm of x plus y, norm 1 of x plus y is less than equals to norm 1 of x plus norm 1 of y. So we have shown all the three properties which are here, all the three properties. So we can say that the definition given by here of the norm is correct. I mean this is a norm. So this is how we define norm 1 of vector x. Now let us come to the second part. Norm 2 of in Rn, norm 2 of vector x on Rn can be defined like this. It is square of all the vectors, sum of square of vectors and the under root of that expression. That is a norm 2 of vector x. So it is also it also defines a norm. So how we can show this? Now here x norm of x2 we are taking as sum from I from 1 to n xi is square and whole under root. That is x1 square plus x2 square and so on up to xn square whole power 1 by 2. So the first property is that norm of vector is always greater than or equal to 0, which is true because you see all these quantities are non-negative. So under root is defined and under root is always greater than or equal to 0. So this is obviously true by the definition. This is obviously true. Norm of norm 2 of x is always greater than or equal to 0 for any x. This is true by the definition itself. Now we have to show that norm of x2 is equal to 0 if and only if x equal to 0. Now if x is 0, that means x1, x2 up to xn all are 0. So if x is 0, so this expression is 0, so norm of x2 is obviously 0. If x is 0, then that means norm of x2 is obviously 0. Now let norm of x, norm 2 of x is equal to 0. So this implies under root of x1 square plus and so on up to xn square is equal to 0. So this implies x1 square plus and so on up to xn square is equal to 0. And since it is a sum of square of positive quantities and it is equal to 0, this means xi square equal to 0 for all I, and this means xi equal to 0 for all I, and this means x equal to 0. So we have shown that if norm is equal to 0, that means x itself equal to 0. So the first property we have shown. Now, second property is norm of kx must be equals to mod of k into norm of x. So, norm of x2, which is by the definition, that means we are multiplying each xi is by k. So, what is the norm of this quantity then? By the definition, it is k square x1 square plus k square xn square whole power half 1 by 2. So, k square 1 by 2 will come out. It is x1 square and so on up to xn square whole raised to a 1 by 2, and this is mod k into norm of x, norm 2 of x. So, second property also holds true. Okay. Now, we have to show a third property. So, how we can show a third property? The third property is norm of x plus y is less than equals to norm of x plus norm of y. This we have to show in order to show that this is a norm. Okay. So, this will be equal to, by the definition, it is summation I from 1 to n. Each element of x plus y will be xi plus yi. You make it square, sum all the components, sum of square of all the components to the power 1 by 2. That will be xi plus yi whole square whole raised to power 1 by 2. So, we have to show that norm of x plus y 2 will be less than equals to norm of x 2 plus norm of y 2. This we have to show. Okay. So, what this expression is? This expression by this from here is summation I from 1 to n x I plus y I whole square whole raised to power 1 by 2 is less than equals to summation I from 1 to n x I square whole raised to power 1 by 2 plus summation I from 1 to n y I square whole raised to power 1 by 2. We have to show that this inequality is true. Now, let us square both the sides. If you square both the sides, what we will obtain? We will obtain sum from I from 1 to n x I plus y I whole square is less than equals to x I square, sum of x I square I from 1 to n plus sum of y I square I from 1 to n plus 2 times these two expressions, that is sum of I of x I square whole raised to 1 by 2 and sum of I y I square whole raised to power 1 by 2. And when you further simplify this, what we will obtain? You see, a plus b whole square is a square plus b square plus 2ab. So, square square will cancel out. So, 2 will cancel from this 2. So, what we will obtain finally from here after simplification? This expression we will obtain. Okay. Now, if anyhow we prove that this is true, then this means this is true. And this means this is true. So, that means we have done. Okay. So, anyhow we have to prove that this expression is true. So, now let us try to prove that this expression is true, and this is also called Cauchy-Sequard's inequality. So, how we will prove Cauchy-Sequard's inequality for this real case? Let us see. Now, you see it is simply can be proven using quadratic expression. How we can do that? You simply consider this polynomial. Consider, you see, it is x1 z plus y1 whole square plus x2 z plus y2 whole square and so on up to xn z plus yn whole square. This is always greater than equal to 0. This is very obvious. Sum of square quantities, sum of non-negative expressions always greater than equal to 0. Okay, that is very true. Now, what we will obtain from here? From obtain, if you simplify this, what we obtain? It is z square times sum over I of x I squares, okay, plus twice of sum over I x I y I into z plus sum of y I square. It is greater than equal to 0. You simply open each square and you simplify, you will get this expression. So this is something like AZ square plus BZ plus C greater than equal to 0, where A is this expression, B is twice of this expression and C is this expression. Now if a polynomial of degree 2 is greater than equal to 0, what does it mean for any Z? Z is an arbitrary variable. If Z is an arbitrary variable and for any arbitrary variable this expression is always greater than or equal to 0, this means a parabola, because a quartic polynomial always represents a parabola. So this parabola for any arbitrary Z is always greater than or equal to 0, this means parabola is always on the upper side, okay, either this or this for any Z. That means it has at most one root, it has at most one real root. So this means it has at most one real root. So this implies the discriminant of this polynomial will be less than or equal to 0. And what is the discriminant? Discriminant b square. B is here, b is this expression, b square, that is this whole square minus 4ac, a is this, c is this, is less than equal to 0. Now 4 will cancels out with 0, 4 will go with 0. So what we obtain from here, that summation over I xi yi whole square is less than equal to sum over I xi square into sum over I yi square. So this is the same expression which is here. If you take under root both the sides, we get the same expression over here. If this is true, this is true, and if this is true, then this is true, and hence this is true. So we obtain the third inequality over here, okay. So hence we can say that the norm which is induced in this manner, I mean the definition of norm is true. The next is, so this is a norm 2 of vector x. Now norm, infinite norm of vector x is given as maximum of mod of xi. This simply a notation, infinite norm, okay. It is now it is also a norm induced in a vector x. Now this is very easy to show again. We have to show all the three properties. You see, infinite norm vector x is maximum over I of mod xi, where x is x1, x2 up to xn. Now the first property is norm is always greater than or equal to 0, which is obviously true because we are taking maximum of absolute values which can't be negative, number 1. So first property, that the norm of this quantity is always greater than or equal to 0, it is obviously true by the definition itself. Now if x is equal to 0, of course norm, infinite norm will be 0, because then maximum will be 0. And if norm infinite is equal to 0, this means maximum over I of mod xi equal to 0, and each mod xj is always less than equals to maximum over mod of xi. You see, because xj is always less than equal to maximum over mod xi, it's always true, and it is equal to 0 by this. That means mod xj is less than equal to 0 for all j. If it is less than equal to 0 for all j, it means what? 0. So because it can't be less than 0, it is a mod value, can't be less than 0. So xj will be equal to 0 for all j, and that means x equal to 0. Okay, so we have shown that x equal to 0 if this happens. So the first property holds. Now second property is norm of kx, we have to show. So it is easy to show again, norm of kx size, and it is mod of k times maximum over I mod of xi, which is equals to mod k times norm x infinite. So second property obviously hold. Similarly, we can easily show the third property also. In this case, norm of x plus y is equal to maximum over I mod of x I plus y I. And since mod of x I plus y I is less than or equals to mod x I plus mod y I, you take the maximum both the sides and you can easily obtain that this is less than or equal to maximum over I mod of x I plus maximum over I mod of y I, which is equals to norm infinite x plus norm infinite y. So, hence we have shown all the three properties for this norm. So, this is the norm induced on the vector x. The last one here is the norm p norm on a vector x, where p is greater than equal to 1. If p is equal to 2, so it will be a norm 2, okay, of a vector x is defined like this. Okay. So, we can prove all the three properties of this norm also. For the third one, we have to use generalized Cauchy-Seguin inequality. Okay. So, suppose you are having this vector 1 minus 1 2 and you want to find out one norm of this vector. So, what is the first norm of this vector? What is x here? X is 1 minus 1 2. Now, norm 1 of this vector, we have already defined it is I from 1 to n mod of x I is norm 1 and here n is 3. So, it is summation I from 1 to 3 mod of x I is, which is mod 1 plus mod minus 1 plus mod 2, which is 4. What is norm 2 of this? Norm 2 is simply square of each x I is and the under root of this power half, that will be, it is 4 plus 1 plus 1 6, that is under root 6. Norm infinite norm of this will be maximum over I of mod x I. Now, mod of first quantity is 1, mod of second quantity is 1, mod of third quantity is 2, that is maximum of mod 1 mod minus 1 mod 2, which is 2. So, this is norm infinite norm of this vector. So, in this way we can find out norm 1, norm 2, norm infinite or p norm for any p greater than equal to 1. Okay. Now, how can you define matrix norm, norm of a matrix? So, let us see here. Suppose we are having a m cross n real or complex matrix. The norm of a real or complex matrix of order m cross n is a real valued function which satisfies the following properties. Okay. What are those properties? The first property is the same as a vector norm, that is norm of a matrix is always getting equal to 0 and this is equal to 0 if and only if A is a 0 matrix or a null matrix. The first property is same. The second property is also same, that is norm of alpha A is equal to mod of alpha times norm of A, where alpha is a scalar, may be real or complex. Now, norm of A plus B is less than equals to norm of A plus norm of B. So, these three properties are similar to those properties which we have discussed for finding norm of a vector. Instead of vector, we are having a matrix A. Okay. Additionally, in case of a square matrices, some matrix norm satisfy this condition also. That is norm of A plus B, A into B is less than equals to norm of A into norm of B. And a matrix norm that satisfies this additional property is called submultiplicative norm. Okay. That is true for square matrices, may be true for square matrices. Now, what are the various methods to induce a norm in a matrix? So, what are the various things? The first is maximum column sum, which we are denoting by a norm 1 of a matrix A. What is this? This is you sum all the mod of all the columns and you take the maximum over j, that is the maximum column sum. Let us take this this thing, then it will be clear. You see, you are having a matrix of order m cross n. Matrix A may be A11, A12, A1n, A21, A22 and so on up to A2n, AM1, AM2 and so on up to AMN. This is a matrix A. Okay. Now, what is norm 1 of this matrix? Norm 1. This we are taking as maximum. You are adding all these columns, mod of this column, mod of this element plus mod of this element, mod of this element, the first element. Similarly, mod and sum of this second column, third column, and then you are taking the maximum. Okay. That means what? That means you are taking the sum mod of Aij. Here I is varying from 1 to n and the maximum over j. Okay. I think that is the matrix. Okay. Here it is I from 1 to m. Okay. I is varying from 1 to m. Okay. Now, let us try to prove that this is the norm first of all. That means satisfy all the three properties. So, the first property is norm of norm 1 is always greater equal to 0, which is of course true because you are adding the non-negative quantities and then taking the maximum, which can't be negative. So, it is obviously true by the definition itself. Now, if A is a null matrix, then this is, if A is a null matrix, if A is equal to 0, then of course, norm 1 of matrix is equal to 0. Okay. Now, let norm 1 of this matrix is equal to 0, then we have to show that A only possibility is A is 0. Now, I mean null matrix. The norm is equal to 0, this means what? This means maximum over j sum I from 1 to m mod of a I j is equal to 0. Okay. Now, maximum of a I j, maximum of sum of this is equal to 0 means what? You see, this means maximum over j, the first element is mod a 1 1 plus mod a 2 1 plus and so on, mod a 1 m 1. Okay. The second and similarly the last element is mod a 1 n plus mod a 2 n plus and so on, mod a m n is equal to, this is equal to 0, maximum of this is equal to 0. Now, maximum of this is equal to 0 means what? Each element, I mean suppose maximum is obtained at j equal to p. Okay. That means, suppose this is equals to a mod a 1, suppose it is obtained at p, that means mod a 1 p plus mod a 2 p plus and so on, mod a m p is equal to 0, if maximum is obtained at j equal to p. Now, each values, each a 1 i plus a 2 I plus and so on a m I will be less than equals to a 1 p plus and so on a m p, because this is a maximum value and which is 0 for all I, and this sum of non-negative quantity is less than equal to 0, it can't be negative because it is a sum of non-negative expressions. So, this means it is equal to 0. This means it is equal to 0, and if it is equal to 0, this means each aij, each a1i equal to 0 for all I, a1i equal to 0, a2i equal to 0. So, that means okay, that means matrix A is equal to 0. So, we have shown that the first property holds for norm 1 of a matrix A. Now, if you go to a second property by the using this definition, if you go for the second property, norm 1 is defined as maximum over j sum I from 1 to m mod of a I j. So, norm of k a 1 will be maximum over j, it is summation I from 1 to m mod of k I j, which is mod k times, it can be easily taken out because k is a scalar expression, a scalar quantity, which is maximum over j sum over I from 1 to m mod of a I j. So, it is mod k times norm A of 1. And similarly, we can show the third properties also, that norm of A plus B nor 1 of A plus B is less than or equals to nor 1 of A. This property we have to show you see you take the left hand side okay which is equals to maximum over j sum I from 1 to m mod of a I j plus b I j maximum over this okay. Now again you can use mod of a I j plus b I j is less than equals to mod of a I j plus mod of b I j. Now you take the sum over I both the sides okay. If you take the sum of over I both the sides and now you take the maximum both the sides you will get the required expression required this expression okay. So hence we can say that the definition of this is a norm induced on the matrix A which we are calling as norm 1 okay. Similarly we can define maximum row sum instead of column sum we are taking row sum and then we are taking the maximum. So this we are denoting by a norm infinite of a matrix A. Similarly we can go the proof of this. Next is Euclidean norm. Now Euclidean norm is simply you take square of all the elements of the matrix A and the under root of this. Sum of square of all the elements of matrix A and you take the under root. This is the Euclidean norm of matrix A and this can also be obtained by finding trace of A transpose A. Trace is sum of diagonal elements. You find the sum of diagonal elements of A transpose A, take put it under root, you will get the same expression. This you can easily verify and it is a norm. This we can prove also. So these are three different norms which can be induced on a matrix A. This is norm 1, this is infinite norm and this is Euclidean norm on a matrix A. Now suppose you have this problem. In this problem what is A? A is 2 minus 1 0, 3 1 minus 2, minus 2 0 2. Now what is norm 1 of this matrix? Norm 1 of this matrix is simply you find absolute of sum of each column and then take the maximum. That means maximum of mod of 2 is 2, mod of 2 plus mod of 3 plus mod of minus 2, mod of minus 1 plus mod of 1 plus mod of 0, mod of 0 plus mod of minus 2 plus mod of 2. Now here maximum will be it is 2 plus 2 plus 3 that is 7, then it is 2, then it is 4, so that is 7. So maximum I mean norm 1 of this matrix is 7 okay. Now what is norm infinite norm of this matrix? It is maximum of from you take now the columns now the rows sorry it is mod 2 plus mod minus 1 plus mod 0 mod 3 plus mod 1 plus mod minus 2, mod minus 2 plus mod 0 plus mod 2. It is maximum of 2 plus 1 3, 5 and 1 6 and it is 4. So maximum is 6. And what is Euclidean norm of this matrix A? It is you simply find square of all the elements, sum of square of all the elements, it is 4 plus 1 plus 0 plus 9 plus 1 plus 4 plus 4 plus 0 plus 4 and the under root of this which is it is you can easily find it is 4, 8, 12, 13, 14, 18, 18 plus 9 is 27. You can again check it is 5, 5 plus 10 is 15, 15 plus 12 is 27. So it is 27 under root of 27. So in this way we can find out norm 1 infinite norm or Euclidean norm of a matrix. Now when we can say that matrix is compatible, a norm of a matrix which is given by this is said to be compatible or consistent with a norm of vector x if norm of A into x is a, here x is a vector and A is a matrix. So, norm of Ax, if it is less than equals to norm of A into norm of x, then we say that norm of a matrix is compatible with the norm of vector x. So, if this inequality hold, then we say that norm of a matrix A is compatible with the norm of a vector. Now, we have again another result, that let A be a matrix of order n and let C belongs to, let x belongs to Cn. Then the function which is a matrix of order n cross n C to R, defined by this expression where x is non-zero, is a matrix norm. It is also a matrix norm. Here x is a vector. Okay. So, the proof is very easy. One can easily show the proof. You have to show all the three properties of matrix norms. This can be easily obtained. Okay. So, we can show that, we can easily show that this is a norm. Okay. A spectral norm. Now, let A be a matrix of order n. The spectral norm of a matrix A is defined as largest eigenvalue of A conjugate transpose A whole raised to power 1 by 2. If A is a real matrix, it will be A transpose A. If A is a complex matrix, it is A conjugate transpose A whole raised to power half. So, you find the largest eigenvalue of this matrix, take the under root of that, that is the norm 2 of a matrix A, and we are also calling as spectral norm of A. So, for a real matrix, spectral norm is simply largest eigenvalue of A transpose A whole raised to power 1 by 2. Okay. Suppose you want to find out the spectral norm of this matrix. So, what this matrix is? This matrix is 1 plus iota, 1 minus iota and 2. It is basically a complex matrix. So, we will find A conjugate transpose A. Okay. So, what is A conjugate transpose? Which is A conjugate transpose? What is A conjugate first? A conjugate is 1 minus iota, 1 plus iota and 2 its transpose, which is 1 minus iota, 1 plus iota and 2. So, it is basically A itself. So, it is basically Hermitian matrix. If A is equals to A conjugate transpose, means it is a Hermitian matrix. So, it is basically A square. Okay. For norm 2 of A, you have to find out the largest eigenvalue of A conjugate transpose A whole raised to power 1 by 2. That is the largest eigenvalue of A square whole raised to power 1 by 2. So, you find out the largest eigenvalue of A, square it, that will be the largest eigenvalue of A square, because we know that if lambda is the eigenvalue of A, then lambda square will be the eigenvalue of A square. So, you find out the eigenvalues of this matrix. How to find eigenvalue of this matrix? You simply put this equal to 0. So, this implies 1 minus lambda, 2 minus lambda, minus 1 minus iota square will be 0. So, this is lambda square minus 3 lambda plus 2 minus 2 equal to 0. So, that is lambda equal to 0 and 3. So, the largest eigenvalue of A is 3. So, what is the largest eigenvalue of A square? It is 9. Okay. So, this will be simply 9 raised to power 1 by 2, which is 3. So, in this way we can find out the spectral norm of a matrix A, or norm 2 of a matrix A. Okay. So, this is how we can find out norm of a vector and norm of a matrix. Okay. So, in the next few lectures we will see that how we can, what are the applications of norm of a matrix. Okay. Thank you.